So I think that's all our intimation. So I will ask you to please stand as we sing our invocation and the Bible and the offering are brought forward. The Lord together, singing, we gladly worship the Lord. Those who are traveling away. Singing, we gladly worship the Lord together. Singing, we gladly worship the Lord. Those who are traveling the road of life, sow seeds of peace and love. Our call to worship. Let us pause and consider God's point of view. God is outside time and space, for God created both. When we pray, God hears us. When the time is right, God responds. When we pray, God knows our needs. When his time is right, God meets our needs. Let us come to God in our worship now. And so we will stand again and sing hymn 132, Immortal, Invisible. So, words to start us thinking. So I'm just going to start off with two quotes about prayer. Our prayers may be awkward, our attempts may be feeble, but since the power of prayer is in the one who hears it and not in the one who says it, our prayers do make a difference. And that's a quote from Max Lucado. And this is one from Billy Graham. True prayer is a way of life, not just for use in cases of emergency, make it a habit, and when the need arises, you will be in practice. And this was from the Roots material, and it asked us to think about how we would respond to these statements. And it's in light of the passage that we're going to hear read in a little while about the widow who was persistent with a judge to get her plea heard. But it made me think about prayer and how our lives are sometimes just so busy, and finding time to just be still can be difficult. And also, we've thought about faith, and the disciples asked Jesus, you know, how could they have more faith? But they also asked him how to pray. And I thought on Pete Gregg's book, How to Pray. And I want to read just a little bit from it. And I think if I find the first bit. And this is just in the introduction. And it said, when one of our sons heard that I was writing a book about how to pray, he said, oh, but that's easy. You just say, dear God, and you chat to him a bit, and then you say, amen. In a way, he was right. And sometimes we make prayer more complicated than it needs to be. So How to Pray was written as a simple guide for normal people. And it's an introduction to a vast subject aimed at new Christians and ordinary followers of Jesus who may not have studied theology and don't consider themselves ninja prayer warriors, but who would still quite like to grow and go a bit deeper in the relationship with God. And so if you've not read this book and you would like to, then he goes on to say it's going to be a bit wild and a wonderful journey of discovery, which it is, because he goes through lots of things on difficulties. But he also has a bit that says how to read this book in a couple of minutes. And he's really got four things. And it's how to pray. The disciples said, Lord, teach us to pray. Every pilgrim gets a stone in their shoe eventually. And you wake up one morning thinking, is this really all there is to knowing the creator of 100 billion galaxies? You read the book of Acts and ask, why isn't it like that anymore? Your world falls apart and you desperately need a miracle. You stare up at the stars and feel things bigger than religious language. You say to yourself, if this thing is true, there's got to be more power, more mystery, more actual personal experience. And so finally, you turn to God, half wondering whether you any more than half serious, and say, Lord, teach me to pray. And he replies, I thought you'd never ask. So he's got pray, which stands for pause. So we have to stop and pause and think about prayer. Be still and know that I am God. And rejoice is the other part. You know, you look at, he goes on to say about the Northern Lights. Now, I've never seen the Northern Lights, but I believe they are really amazing. And I'll see on sometimes on BBC Breakfast Television that the Northern Lights have been up in the north. And I think, I've maybe just been awake and gone out and looked, I might have seen them. But they are incredible. And, you know, I think if we start to improve our prayer life and we rejoice with God, then things for us too can be incredible. Because like an eagle soaring, a horse galloping, or a salmon leaping, worship is the thing God's designed us to do. And then there is the asking, you know, because sometimes we think prayer, we just go, God, I want this, I want that, I want the next thing, you know, and you think you must get fed up listening to this list of I wants. But yes, we do have to ask, you know, he invites us to ask God. You know, the Lord's Prayer invites us to ask God for everything from daily bread to thy kingdom come, for ourselves, for others. And so when you get to the ask bit, that section is explored a bit more deeply. And then it's about yielding. And he talks about this as the final step in the dance of prayer, and it's surrender. It's a clenched fist slowly opening, an athlete lowering himself into the ice bath, and I can think of nothing worse than an ice bath. A field of Californian poppies turning to the sun. We yield to God's presence on earth as it is in heaven through contemplative prayer and by listening to his word, which is our daily bread. And we yield to God's holiness through confession and reconciliation, praying, forgive us our sins as we forgive others. And we yield to his power in spiritual warfare, asking our Father to deliver us from evil. And so in all these ways, it's by surrendering to God that we overcome. By emptying ourselves, we are filled. And by yielding our lives in prayer, that our lives themselves can become a prayer. And it really is an amazing book. And also, there is an app. For those of you who are good with your smartphones, there is an app called Lectio 365, which is based on this, and it goes through every day. And they're only little 15-minute sections, so it's easy to do, easy to use. And it's pause, rejoice, ask, and yield. And it really is, they do them in the morning, and they have an evening one. And it is a nice way to start and end your day. And so we're going to think about prayer as we go through our worship, and hopefully to have a time where we can be quiet and still. But let's say together the Lord's Prayer. Let's pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And I thought we would just be still and listen to a video on, and it's the Lord's My Shepherd. It's the Townsend version, but if we just fill and listen to it.
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still, still waters. His goodness restores my soul.
He guides my way in righteousness.
of time to be quiet and still. But let's draw near to God with our opening prayer. Let's pray. Lord, you are the one who watches over us. You are always present, ever loving, ever faithful. You are creator and redeemer, and we praise you for your kindness and justice and for all that you are. Lord, forgive us when we have closed our eyes to the things that matter, when we have prioritized the trivial surface matters over urgent needs and deep-seated injustice. Forgive us when we have chosen to look away from those who need us the most. Forgive us when we have stretched ourselves so thin that we do not have time and energy for that which you called us to do and to be. Forgive us and restore us, we pray. Lord, thank you that you are our place of help. Where others fail us and circumstances change, you remain and you are unchanging. Your love supports us, underpinning us with a strength beyond ourselves. We praise you for your passion for justice, for your kindness towards your people. We thank you that you call us to a life-giving existence that we may give and receive in your name, learning your ways and caring for your world. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And now we are going to hear from the Bible our readings. We will hear from Psalm 121 and from Luke 18, verses 1 to 8. And Patsy will read for us this morning.
The first reading today is Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. The next reading is Luke 18, verses 1 to 8, and it's a parable of the persistent widow. Then Jesus told his disciples a parable to show them that they should always pray and not give up. He said, "In a certain town there was a judge who neither feared God nor cared about men. And there was a widow in that town who kept coming to him with the plea, 'Grant me justice against my adversary.' For some time he refused, but finally he said to himself, 'Even though I don't fear God or care about men, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will see that she gets justice, so that she won't eventually wear me out with her coming.' And the Lord said, 'Listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not God bring about justice for his chosen ones who cry out to him day and night? Will he keep putting them off? I tell you, he will see that they get justice and quickly. However, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth?'" May the Lord bless this reading from his holy word.
And we're going to sing again from CH4, And it's hymn 81. I to the hills will lift mine eyes. Hymn 81. In the reading today, we hear about a widow who was very persistent. She kept coming to the judge with a plea for justice against her adversary. And to understand the first few verses of this parable, let's review the background information on each of the participants. In Jesus' day, district judges would go from town to town and charge money to make legal decisions regarding disputes. The judge would set up his court in a tent, and his assistants would decide which of the numerous cases would come before him. While most cases were brought before the elders of the local synagogue, the widow in this parable is said to plead with this district judge to have her case tried. While this widow hoped she might get justice against her adversary by one who was supposed to be unbiased, objective and neutral, to her dismay, she found the judge was found to be a man of the world. And even though honouring God and one's fellow human beings was upheld as ideals throughout the Hellenistic world, we are told this judge neither feared God nor cared for anyone except himself. Without any remorse, this judge refused to hear the widow's repetitive demands for justice, despite knowing that widows were often the object of God's special love and care, as we hear about them in various passages of the Bible. The judge felt he was not accountable to anything outside himself. He simply ignored the widow to attend to the cases of more prominent and better paying citizens. The second character in Jesus' parable, the widow, is seen as a hopeless victim. In an age when social services were almost exclusively dependent on human goodwill, widows, orphans, and the sick and needy were exposed to a precarious social existence of being dependent on a male family member or the community of God's people. The unrighteous judge in this parable showed no interest in hearing the widow's case for a variety of likely reasons. First, being a woman and a widow, she had little intrinsic value to the community and precious few laws to protect her in what was at that time truly a man's world. Second, She had no husband or kinsman to come alongside her and assist her. And third, being poor, she lacked the resources needed to bribe the judge to select her case among the likely overwhelming cases waiting to be heard. The obstinacy of the judge and defencelessness of the widow would seem to doom the widow's prospectus of success. And yet, despite having absolutely nothing going for her, just like the hemorrhaging woman of Luke in chapter 8, verses 43 to 48, this widow assumes unusual responsibility for her own well-being by continuously and publicly demanding her case be heard. One can almost picture her in the court, following the judge in the streets, standing outside his house if she finds it, screaming at the top of her voice, saying, "Grant me justice against my adversary." She had nothing to give him, nothing to offer him. The only thing she had was her persistence and trying to find justice for herself. When we come to God, we have nothing to offer. We have nothing to give him. The only thing that we can do is come to him often, making our prayers known to him and believing in his love. Because that's what we're doing when we come, continually lifting up our prayers to God. We are in essence saying, "God, I trust you, I believe in you, and you are my hope." If there's anything we can learn from this widow woman, it would be this: be persistent, don't give up, don't stop praying. Too many times when we're praying about a situation or about a person or about a problem, when we see no results, we become less likely to pray. When things stay the same way or a person doesn't change, we begin to give up. Or sometimes we become sidetracked about what we've been praying for. It becomes less important than what has got our attention at the present time. This widow never took her eyes off receiving justice for herself. It was the most important thing to her. That is why she wouldn't leave the judge alone until she received justice for herself. The widow woman went daily to see the judge, as we should go daily to God, with our request, with our situations, with our circumstances, and with our petitions. We should go daily. She didn't wait for someone else to go to the judge. She didn't expect anyone else to go to the judge. She did it herself. She didn't leave it up to others. She didn't say, "Oh, well, nobody else will pray about it. Someone else will pray about it. Someone else will be concerned about it. Someone else will get involved in it." She went to the judge for herself, just like we to go to God for ourselves. We are also supposed to go to God on behalf of others. You might well think somebody else is praying for someone. Somebody else is going to be concerned. But we should never just leave it up to other people. We should also be praying. We should also be ones seeking. We should be ones knocking. We should be the ones asking. We should be the same way when we're asking God for something. We should not give up. We should stay focused on what we're praying about until we receive an answer from God. There may be more, but I know that there are at least three answers that comes from God. There is yes, there is no, and there is wait. And it's similar to what Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, where he said, "Ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and the door will be opened." Be persistent in asking and you will receive. Be persistent in seeking and you will find. Be persistent in knocking and the door will be opened. Prayer is the work of the church, collectively and individually, whether silent or liturgical or in any other form. Prayer is a channel for our relationship with God. If prayer appears to go unanswered, it seems like God doesn't always rescue us. Or if we don't know how to pray about the big, difficult questions, then how can we address these issues? Can we pray about how to pray? We should. And we can certainly meet together to share our difficulties with each other and offer support and guidance through conversation, through coming to worship, through Bible studies, and other times where we gather for prayer. And it's whether it's about climate change, the state of the economy, changes in society, violent conflict, or personal burdens. These are all situations that concern God. How persistent are we in sharing these concerns with God? We live in a culture that expects a quick fix to small problems, and we can mistakenly carry that attitude over to the weightier matters. On TV shows, we see a house refurbished in a day, a band made famous overnight, no preparation or hard work required. But the church's work of prayer is not about the quick fix. It's about laying foundations that will last. And how does this idea challenge our attitude to prayer? So we're going to put on a reflective video, and it's called In Your Time, which we can just sit and reflect and listen to the words. Going to have the opportunity to sing ourselves now, and it's CH4 710 710. I have a dream, a man once said. Let us draw near to God in prayer with our prayers for others and the world. Let us pray. Loving God, we bless you again for your generosity to us. We ask your blessing on our lives and on the ways we use your gifts of money, time and skills as we seek to follow Jesus and to show the world his love today and every day. Lord God, just as the widow persisted, we persist in our prayers of intercession. We pray for all involved in our justice system, for police officers, judges, lawyers, and all who uphold the law. We pray for all who work in our prisons and for all those serving prison sentence. Lord, we lift our eyes to you. We pray for the ongoing conflict in Ukraine, where Russian strikes have again targeted civilians, for Somalia and the aid workers there. We pray for safe passage for lorries and workers to reach those in need. We pray for families everywhere, of those killed in the nursery in Thailand and those in the garage explosion in Ireland. We pray for widows, orphans, the needy and the vulnerable. We pray for our own loved ones and for our communities. For those who are fearing the prospects of blackouts this winter and dreading escalating debt due to the ever-spiraling cost of living. And so now, Lord, we bring before you the people who we know that are in need of prayer this morning. Lord, we lift our eyes to you and we pray for all Christian leaders in our churches, for all your people. You call us to pray, to work at it and not give up. You care about every detail in our lives, from the smallest to the most complex. We place all of this into your hands, for you are the one we can depend on. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And so as we bring our worship to a close this morning, our final hymn is again from CH4 and it's number 547, What a Friend We Have in Jesus, hymn 547. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore.